meetings, and the general public, you may represent those, has, there's never been a screening of it. There's only one other copy, and that's in the Rockham Institute. One or two things to say about the film. First of all, it was made, that says, it's alimentary dystrophy and avitin mimosis. It's about the catastrophic effects of the siege of Leningrad in the first winter, when hundreds of thousands of people died. And what they overwhelmingly died from was what came to be known very soon as dystrophy, alimentary, nutritional dystrophy. Thing to emphasize from a medical point of view is that this was a condition, a disease, an illness that was not known. Can you believe it? The word dystrophy first appears in a Russian dictionary in 1937, and it describes the failure of the metabolism due to insufficiency of food. But it was never in the records of the Soviet health service or of scientific research until it started to happen on, well, a mass scale in Leningrad. The first recorded case of medics and scientists getting together to try to understand what was causing people who were starving to just drop dead was on the 20th of November, and in December, when the famine is really getting a grip, and medics and scientists are struggling with the problems of analyzing it, what is a symptom, what is a cause, and so on and so forth, that's when the word, the term alimentary dystrophy first starts to appear. But it isn't in the media, it isn't in publications until late in 1942, but it does very quickly come to be used by ordinary people, dystrophy or dystrophic to describe the victims of it. So that's how it was. This film, which has the date 1943, was made not, what was the equivalent of general public, it's not a documentary, as I said in my notes, it is for the training, it says, it's a teaching film for medical institutes. And so what you'll see are doctors, specialists, taking their audience of medical students, through the stages, through the symptoms, through the treatments of dystrophy, or of alimentary dystrophy, in its full name. As I said, when I said a word or two about this at the previous meeting, you'd be prepared to be shocked in one or two places, not just by the awful conditions of those who are dystrophics in the third category, which is the one leading to death, but specifically by the autopsy which you see performed. And it's performed for the teaching reason to convey the point that the film is making about the catastrophic effect that starvation has on the metabolism. And this is done by taking out the respective organs, having just opened up like that. And this, you see this and you know how you do autopsies, and taking out this and that and comparing it with the organs of, not a live person, but someone who was healthy before they died. And that, I think, more than anything, gets across the way in which starvation resulted in the organism both feeding on itself, hence emaciation, but also in completely disrupting the balance of the organism, resulting in death. That's all I'll say, but I'll hand over to Jonathan to talk more generally about starvation.
So I'm based at the Institute for Child Health in London, and my specialist area is body composition, and a lot of the work that I'm involved in is either programs that try to prevent malnutrition by giving therapeutic food products in developing countries, or sometimes work in hospitals where we're trying to treat severe acute malnutrition. And this is really the first generation where we do treat people and they survive, and now we actually have survivors of severe acute malnutrition to follow up. If you work with a disease, you always want to know what's the cause of the disease, what's the vector, why can't we get rid of the disease? The problem with malnutrition is that usually the main cause of malnutrition in humans is other humans. And if you look around the world and ask where the malnourished children are, they're in areas where humans are creating the problems that are reaching children. So you can't be a nutritionist and not be interested in power, the organization of society, and so on. Now, if we step back from humans and look at other species, we realize we're not quite so special in having power dynamics over food. And when people first got into game theory, they started playing hawks and doves games to understand how different strategies could result in competition for resources. But a rather more interesting game was developed in the 1980s by Barnard and Sibley, which they called the producer-scrounger game. And they recognized that if you're an animal, you might go and find some food yourself. Or you might wait till someone else has found it and just go and try and steal it. And although this occurs across species, it also occurs within species. And anyone who's been down to the river and looked at seagulls will realize that as soon as one gull finds anything, the other gulls try and go and get it. So there you have producers and scroungers. And the idea of the producer-scrounger game is that if we leave out morality, both of those strategies can be successful. If almost everyone is finding food, you might as well abandon finding food, just go and try and steal it. But if everyone is stealing food, then there isn't any food being found, and so actually it would be more productive for you to go and find it. And so you tend to do whatever the other people aren't doing. So here's a typical producer, and he's got certain characteristics that make him a producer. He needs to bring some food back to his nest. He's a small, dumpy bird, and he's not very agile, and he's got a great big beak full of fish, which is very visible. So this is a puffin, and they nest on islands, and they nest in burrows. The reason is that when they come back to their burrow, this is what's waiting for them. All of these seagulls are going to try and get the sand eels from the puffin. At other times of the year, the seagulls might try and eat the puffin itself, but at this time of the year, what the seagulls are effectively doing is outsourcing their foraging to other individuals, so that all the work of getting the sand eels is done by the puffin, and then the gulls just sit around trying to get the food. So you've got very agile, cunning scroungers and hard-working producers. If the puffin could eat its own food, it would be fine, but it's got to bring it to the nest, and that's what makes it common. Now, when we think of the long term of human evolution, we don't really see much producing and scrounging. We get that view from studying foragers today who don't practice agriculture. And what's really noticeable about foraging populations is they have very low levels of hierarchy. And they really have what we call mutualist relations. They develop these ritualized gift-giving relationships with each other across different networks. And through that, they know who they can depend on if their social group encounters a tough time, famine. They can't find food, they'll get up and they'll walk across and find their gift-giving partner, and that person will support them until the good times have returned. So they've got these systems of reciprocity, and they don't want hierarchy because that won't mess up the reciprocity. But as soon as agriculture emerged, and as soon as food producing efficiency went up, everything changed, and suddenly there were more resources, and scrounging could become a viable strategy. And you can see from these sort of medieval pictures here that agriculture concentrates resources, just like the puppet and his saddles, so that while some people work very hard at producing either stock animals or crops, others can just ride up on horses and be very violent and get hold of the food and get it from that way. So as soon as civilizations emerged that were agricultural, we also see in the archaeological record the emergence of defensive fortified settlements. This is one from 2500 BC in Afghanistan, and it's very much what you would have seen in ancient Mesopotamia, large mud brick walls, which are fairly good at keeping people out. There was a very inventive Spartan king who diverted a river into one city, dissolved the mud bricks back into mud, and then he captured the city. But generally, until siege engines were invented, these kinds of defenses were at least good at keeping attackers at bay. You don't have to go to Afghanistan to see that. These are little rocks, fortified settlements in Scotland. They probably had a sort of signal of status as well as a defensive role, but certainly the outer walls are very thick and they could store food on the inside. And anyone who knows Scottish history will know that the clans were always warring with each other. So what happens there is that this is really the birth of the siege, that the defensive walls on the one hand can protect people on the inside and then people would store food to try and resist the siege. But on the others, they would actually use malnutrition as a weapon of war to try and take that stronghold. They would try and starve the defenders into submission. Initially, warfare was a kind of summer activity where the attackers would live off the crops on the outside and try and starve the people on the inside into submission. And you can find lots of pictures of sieges from antiquity. This is the Assyrians at the British Museum. So you see this routinely in sort of the ancient Middle East. It's also very well described in the Bayeux tapestry. These are lots of bay castles being stormed at the siege of Dinan in the 11th century. And castles were sort of something that went hand in hand with sieges, a specific defensive settlement. And early on, we find that civilians are caught up, not by accident, but they actually use themselves as a weapon of war. So one particularly famous siege was of Alesia by Julius Caesar, and on the inside, Alesia was Persecutorix, the Gaulish chieftain. And Persecutorix had both his army, but he also had a large number of women and children. What Caesar did was he built two different ramparts, one set facing in to surround Alesia, and one set facing outwards to stop any relief force arriving. So, on the inside, the Persecutorix eventually ejected the women and children to try and reduce the drain on his food supplies. Caesar wasn't interested, he just left them to starve in front of his lines, and eventually the Gallic relief force failed to remove Caesar's army, and the Persecutorix had to surrender, and that was the end of independent rule. So civilians are themselves playing a role in how long the siege might last. And the Mongols took this one step further. They would sometimes attack a series of small settlements and defeat them, and all the civilians would flee, and the civilians would fall back on a larger city. But by adding themselves to the food chain, they would therefore run down the food reserves in that larger city faster and make it more vulnerable to capture. So here you can really see how civilians can be used to consume the food and make the siege more successful. So eventually, castles began to fade because of the rise of cannons to destroy the walls, and castles like the Maginot Line in France were just bypassed by the German forces, so they failed to fulfill their protective role. But But that didn't stop starvation being used as a weapon of war. So here we are back in Leningrad. Cities were now the site of factories producing weapons, so cities were very important to capture as part of war strategy. So once again, civilians get caught up, and they can be used once again to increase the likelihood that the city could be captured. So what actually happens during sieges or famines? So one notable thing is that those who die tend to be disproportionately being very young and very old. They're less robust in terms of their physiology, and they have less agency over getting food. So they pay the primary price. We can still see that today. There are more malnourished children around the world than there are malnourished adults. If we look at the body, then all sorts of complex metabolic effects occur. Some of these have been described in studies in the Warsaw Ghetto, and we're clearly going to hear more from the film about what has been learned from Leningrad. One of the effects that's very noticeable is that body temperature falls markedly, so people feel really cold all the time when they're experiencing a famine. There are lots of metabolic changes, blood pressure falls, glucose tolerance falls, so people who have diabetes might actually show a short-term improvement if they have fast. But over the long term, you see many much more serious complications develop. These are collated data on what happens to different organs over long-term starvation. You can see the biggest effect is in body fat, so not surprisingly, we use our body fat as a supply of energy, and that helps resist the fact that we're not gaining so much energy intake. But you can also see that while the brain is very protected, almost all the other organs decrease in mass following the long-term exposure to starvation. What's particularly interesting is that not every species sacrifices its organs in the same way. So these are data compiled by Max Kleiber on the pigeon and the cat, and I just put them on the same graph as the human data. And to some extent, you see a common pattern. So all of the species get rid of their body fat stores, so that's a buffer, to try and save the other organs. And all of the species protect the brain. But in between, an organ like the pancreas is sacrificed by the pigeon, but really quite preserved by the cat. And the heart is extraordinarily protected by the cat. Now, I don't know enough about the value of the organs across these different species, but clearly how you respond to starvation has been shaped by natural selection. And different species have been honed, if you like, to preserve the organs that are most valuable to them if they should survive the malnutrition. What happens during recovery from malnutrition? Well, another very famous study was on conscientious objectors during the Second World War in America. People who didn't want to fight would volunteer to be semi-starved in a specific study. And this is the most detailed and controlled study of energy restriction ever. It's very valuable, but it wasn't as extreme as what happened in continental Europe. Here you can see what happened to the tissues. So weight declines during the semi-starvation period. Most of that decline was in body fat, but lean mass also declined as well. Then there was a period of restricted refeeding, so to a degree, energy supply was restored. And you can see an increase in fat, but really not much recovery in lean mass. And then he moved on to unrestricted refeeding, unlimited free energy supply. And something really amazing happens. There was a massive hyperphagia, increase in appetite, and the body fat shot through the roof and went way past the level of body fat that the people had when they started the study. And that hyperphagia continued until the lean mass had itself restored itself to the baseline level. So you can see how body fat is going down and up, and lean mass is, to some extent, buffered and is the more important protective tissue. So you might think, great, people are malnourished, just give them lots of food and they'll get better. The problem was that what people experienced when they tried to resolve acute malnutrition, for example, when the liberation of the Nazi concentration camps happened, is that they often just killed people by suddenly providing a lot of food. And it became clear that organs such as the heart were so weakened that the stress of restoring nutrition would actually overload atrophied heart muscle, and they would actually kill people. In the decades since the Second World War, we've learned the same thing from trying to treat malnourished children in Africa and Asia. It's the same principle. What you actually first need to do after malnutrition is you've stabilized metabolism, and only when you've done that is it possible to add in extra food and try and promote recovery of body weight and muscle mass and so on. So I just want to focus a little bit more now on the similarity of the way that people respond in their behavior to adversity and the way that the body responds to adversity, because there's something in common, which is that the way that we build defenses against adversity can themselves become their own stress. If our defenses are very strong, then we may actually have to cope with those defenses. You can see that in the castle walls. They're good at keeping out the enemy, but then the enemy can surround your walls and starve you. So you have a defense, but it's now become its own stress. And we can think of that in terms of communities. So a good model for that is the ghetto. And the word ghetto first originated in Venice, where the Jewish population was allowed to live in the city, but only in one particular place, because the Jews were moneylenders, which made them desirable in economic terms, but not desirable in terms of religious protocol. So the Jews were obliged to live in the ghetto, and they had to come back every night and be locked in, and they were even forced to pay for the people who policed their activity. And after the ghetto got its name, a papal bull was rolled out across Europe, and many other European cities did something very similar. This is the Frankfurt ghetto. You can see on the left-hand side the walls surrounding the region where the Jews lived. Now, the walls were very ambiguous, because on the one hand, they oppressed people in a very overcrowded, dense area, which was prone to disease, and very often fires, and so on. So being in a ghetto was a very tough experience. On the other hand, at least in the ghetto, people weren't subjected to violence, because outside in the city, Jews were often blamed for things like the Black Death or economic crises and so on. So the ghetto walls were rather ambivalent. They were constraining you in a stressful area, but they might also protect you from other stresses outside. And a classic account of the Jewish ghetto was written by Lewis Worth in 1928, which is very interesting simply because it was before the Holocaust. And he was fascinated by how when Jewish populations migrated from Europe at the end of the 19th century, and supposedly could free themselves from the ghettos in Europe that had been quite tough living conditions, when they arrived in the New World, they actually restored many of the aspects of ghetto in cities like New York, so that the ghetto somehow replicated itself, even though in theory they could be free. And he argued that traits which had been very successful in responding to being marginalized and adversity in Europe were actually also quite useful traits in the New World when you were struggling to establish yourself as a migrant. And it took several generations for these populations to release themselves from the ghetto, go out into the city and live in the entire city area, so that the ghetto walls were to some extent symbolic after they had originally been physical. And they were to some extent walls in the mind of how you saw yourself. Now, what I want to emphasize is that that's also how the body behaves in response to malnutrition. When we suddenly take away the nutritional stress, the body has made physical adaptations, and you can't just wipe them out. The heart's got smaller. You can't just suddenly give food and expect the heart to get bigger again. It's going to take time for a restoration process to recover. So in each of these processes of recovery, whether it's social marginalization or nutritional stress, it's like peeling back layers of an onion. You need to take away those defensive walls that are now their own stress before you can completely recover from that adversity. So we can actually see one particular population where those two things come together very closely, and that is the Warsaw Ghetto. So when the Jews were locked into the Warsaw Ghetto in the Second World War, a group of doctors decided they needed to study their main public health problem, which was starvation. So a team of about 30 doctors started to systematically study malnutrition, and they did it as scientifically as they could with limited equipment and so on. And they wrote a series of manuscripts, even as one by one these doctors were being shipped off to concentration camps. Eventually, the manuscript was smuggled out of the ghetto and buried in the grounds of the hospital outside. So that by the time the ghetto was raised to the ground, the manuscript was still there. Later on, the manuscript was sent to America, and eventually it was translated and published by Myra Winnick. And it's another book which tells us a lot about what we know about extreme starvation and what it does to the human body. It's a for someone who studies metabolism, the data are very important. Now, Myron, when he realized that people weren't going to read a book on glucose tolerance in extreme starvation, so he converted the book into a novel called Final Stand, where he described the story as he saw it of the doctors. And I really recommend that novel. It is really profound and very readable, and it will give a sort of story of what happened in less scientific times. So it's easily obtainable on the internet, Amazon and so on. There are also several other locations in Europe which experienced famine in the Second World War, and in different ways we've learned a lot about what they do to metabolism. One of the most interesting famines was in Holland near the end of the Second World War, when there was a very specific famine began and ended very suddenly. It began when the Germans reacted to the Dutch responding to a call by the Allies to resist. The Germans punished the Dutch by imposing a food blockade, and that started very suddenly, and it's now known as the Dutch Hunger Winter. But the famine was also lifted very suddenly when the Allies managed to push forward and liberate the cities. And subsequently, what people realized is that they could classify with extraordinary clarity when people were exposed to the famine if they were a baby. So they could make different cohorts who either were born after the famine had started, or who experienced the end of pregnancy during the maternal famine, or the middle of pregnancy, or just the first trimester. So it was possible afterwards to categorize when you were malnourished in utero. This is what happens at birth weight, and you can see that depending on which trimester you were in utero, your birth weight was more or less affected. So it was being in utero in later pregnancy, the second or third trimester, that had a strong effect on birth weight, whereas during early pregnancy, the mother absorbs the nutritional stress.
Any effect on sex ration?
I'm sure there was. Say something. I mean, boys nearly always do worse in these circumstances. If we look in more detail, we can also see how different parts of the body respond. So this is the famine of the first or the second or the third trimester. And you can see that the placenta is much more affected in the second or the third trimester, and so is birth rate. So the third trimester is the worst one to be exposed to famine. But head circumference is relatively protected. So just like in adult life, during fetal malnutrition, the head is the organ that's preserved, and the other organs are sacrificed. And that's why what we see is the long-term consequences, metabolic diseases. Because if you haven't invested in the body in early life, you pay penalties later. These are data on child malnutrition in terms of weight and height declines during the Second World War. You can see that many different populations were affected. There was up to one-fifth of weight loss in Greece. And Greece was one of the populations which had the highest level of famine mortality, despite not really having over a siege. What's very interesting height is that during the war, German children's height actually increased slightly. There's a very fascinating book by Lizzie Collingham about the role of food in the Second World War. And a lot of it, the rationale of Germany was to bring Europe's food into Germany. After the war ended, things were different, and at that point, German children's height declined. But during the war, they bucked the trend that the children elsewhere suffered, with the German children, a little bit of weight loss, but not height loss. Not only height and weight decline, but we can also see where in the body those changes are. So this is some data from the book co-edited by John, and you can see at the top that the Leningrad children exposed to the siege became shorter compared to their Moscow peers. But if you look where in the body it happened, it was entirely due to shorter legs, whereas the height of the trunk was entirely preserved. Now that's very consistent with what we know generally about malnutrition in early life and body proportions. And we use leg length as a marker of an early nutritional insult, and we can measure adults and use that, and we can actually identify people who might need a specific public health approach, or might be having elevated susceptibility to diseases such as diabetes. So even in pregnancy, women with shorter legs are more likely to get gestational diabetes. Now, classic work, partly following the Dutch Hunger Winter, but also with slightly different rationale, has shown that there's a dose-response inverse association between the magnitude of growth in fetal life, as shown here, but also infancy, and the risk of controlling the metabolism, maintaining homeostasis, and therefore keeping the body in good condition in adult life. So these are the risks of heart disease and diabetes in adult life, tracking growth patterns in valley life. And one of the things that has been shown, for example, in the Dutch under winter, is that those exposed to maternal famine in utero went on to have higher risks of diabetes and heart disease in later life. And there's another famine that we can see this in. I'm sorry, this picture is a bit fuzzy, but this is the Ukrainian famine during the imposition of collectivized agriculture in the 1930s. And you can see a big spike in the prevalence of diabetes around 1933, 1934. So this is looking back from the late 20th century, looking at the prevalence of diabetes according to the year of birth. We're finding an elevated risk of diabetes if you were born during that famine. So now we have many more complex tools that we can look inside the body and see what's going on. We talk a lot about epigenetic changes in gene expression. So your DNA is fixed, you can't change that. Those are the genes that you've inherited from your parents. But now we know that each gene is expressed differently according to what exposures it experienced in early life. So people have measured the survivors of those who experienced the Dutch famine in utero, and 6 decades later, you can see differences in their gene expression, and that is contributing to their elevated diabetes risk. And even though those people have never experienced malnutrition after birth, they went on to have smaller babies themselves in the 1960s and 1970s. So you can see these effects propagating across generations. And one of the things that's interesting to me and my colleagues in London is that this really makes warfare and sieges and famine an issue of intergenerational justice. We are seeing penalties paid by people who were not even actually outside the mother at the time when they were exposed to the war. So we're thinking of punishing people for inflicting starvation or war crimes or so on, then some of the penalties, some of what we should take into account, goes forward into future generations. So a lot of this was what I drew on in this book that I published recently called The Metabolic Exodus, where I just got tired of everyone writing about nutrition as if it's a very clinical issue. We don't really notice the power relations at all. You can talk a lot about the way that undernutrition generates metabolic penalties on people, and they pay them in their own, throughout their own lives, and they may pass them on to the next generation. We can also see obesity is the same problem, because maternal obesity affects the health of the fetus, and that will affect its risk of diabetes in later life as well. And really, the quality of nutrition and the organization of society are fundamentally related, so that we hear the government giving us public health advice. I find it quite frustrating because really the structure of society hands us out our opportunities to be healthy or not, so that there's a limit to what we can do through individual agency. And really much of what is happening to people is beyond their control. I'd also like to recommend a few things if anyone does want to read further. There's some classic, quite scientific books lower down. Bradley's book on medieval sieges is fascinating. I mean, sieges turn out to be very interesting. Obviously, they're very stressful, but we can learn a lot from them. And then there are these classic books about what happens following a siege in early life. So, thank you for listening. And anyone